following interview was conducted with Professor David W. Krogmann, Professor Emeritus of Biochemistry for the Purdue University Oral History Program. It took place on Wednesday, September 3rd, 2008, at his office on campus. The interviewer was Katherine Markee, the Oral History Library. Welcome. Tell us a little bit about where you were born and your parents and early years.
I was born in Washington, D.C. On October 21st, 1931. My parents were children of immigrants. My father's from Germany and my mother's from Ireland. I went to school in the Catholic school system there. And
in Washington?
In Washington, and went to Catholic University in Washington and took a bachelor's degree in biology. I went to Johns Hopkins University and took a PhD degree in biochemistry.
Can you tell us a little about what college life was like? Did you live on campus?
No. In Washington, of course, I was in the family home, and I almost walked to school, even to the university. In Baltimore, graduate students generally took rooms out in the neighborhoods, and the undergraduates had dormitories and things like that.
What was campus like? Life, were you a student, any student activities when you were there? Athletics or? And your major was in biochem then as well?
Yeah, no, in the PhD programs.
In undergrad,
there were some social clubs and there were some occasional dances that one could go to.
Yeah.
It was pleasant. And I always had this wonderful asset of being able to go downtown and look at the museums and hunt about in the various zoos and all that kind of nice stuff. So
there's a lot of cultural activities.
Yeah, there's lots to be done.
Right. Then when you graduated, had you decided to go to grad school, or and how did you select Johns Hopkins?
Well, I, in the course of the undergraduate work, it struck me that to be a teacher and a scientist would be a very nice thing. And I began to realize a bit about the great world that lay outside. When the time came, I sent in applications to a number of universities, and I had gall of applying to Harvard University, and they sent me back a form, and it began with, how many stocks and bonds do you own? And the next line was, how many stocks and bonds do your parents own? And my parents struggled through the depression, and they didn't have any of the stocks, and I threw it away. I thought, that's another world. I wasn't all that interested in it.
Wow.
So I had written to several others, and Johns Hopkins got in touch with me and said, why don't you come out and look us over? And so I went there, looked over, and said, we'll find a way that we can keep you in room and board, and we'll do something about your tuition as well, so you can afford to come here. So that was fine. I was delighted.
Had you decided that biochem was the area you...
Yes. I somehow came to that conclusion because I had to struggle with chemistry, and biology was pretty easy, but it struck me that it was just at its beginning that there was going to be a lot of interesting things happen. So it would be a nice science to be in, and it was. I think I got on the train at just the right moment and rode through all these great discoveries that have come from it.
Were you married at the time you were in grad school?
No. When I finished grad school, I married.
Did you meet in the graduate school?
Yes.
Uh-huh.
My wife was a technician at Johns Hopkins, and down the hall of ways.
What was Johns Hopkins like? What year were you, or what years were you there?
Let me try to catch that up for you. It must have been 54, to about 58 that I was there. And it was a place where everyone talked about being something like a part of the Ivy League. It's not quite official, but...
You're in the ballpark.
Yeah, there's a lot of that kind of conversation.
It's a long, older school, long established.
Yes. I had a nice experience, and at one time I had a job working in a hospital, the Johns Hopkins Hospital, which is far from the regular campus. And there I worked for a pediatrician. He was a very nice man. I enjoyed his company. He was studying lead poisoning in children, and so I would analyze some things, look for the lead and that sort of stuff. And he had this great idea. He said, arrange to come here at 11 and leave when you want to, but I want you to have lunch with us. So I thought, isn't that nice, Matt? So I go there, and the staff of the pediatrics department would always have lunch together, and the chairman of the department was a lovely gentleman. I really admired him and his wife. And all the young Turks would be at the table trying to ask questions about what do you think about breastfeeding and all these sorts of things. And he always answered in a very nice measure of what and so forth. So that was a very nice thing to see that and to see.
It enhanced your graduate.
Yes. But life was like in the medical community. So that was a very nice experience there. But generally speaking, in graduate school, I was there for 10 hours a day, 6 days a week.
Were you fortunate in getting funding all support most of the time you were there?
Yes. Yeah.
Because in those days, it was not easy to get much branding as there is today, is it right?
Yeah, well, in the first years, it was they fixed me up with jobs where there was money available because services
could be
remembered, so I did that. And then eventually I got an NIH sort of scholarship to finish my degree there. And of course, at the time in graduate school, began to attend scientific meetings and see, you know, sort of the national world of it. And it was striking at that time there were a lot of Europeans in the United States, young men who were seeking PhDs or postdoctoral fellows, more likely, who had come from lots of places. And I gathered that Europe was still trying to recover from World War II, and they sent people abroad because there was machinery and chemistry and all this good stuff available here.
In the U.S.
So I realized over the course of the time I was there that I had made friends with people from lots of different places. And that was a nice experience because I knew them for the rest of my life, in effect. And so that was a nice thing. And I went to a scientific meeting there. They sent me to the University of Connecticut for a meeting, and this name, Barney Axelrod, turned up. He had come to Purdue about the time I started graduate school. And my mentor said, oh, I know Barney. He's a wonderful man. I published a paper with him when I was a postdoc. Then I ran into a student who had just come from Purdue, and he said, we have this new man, Barney Axelrod. He plays softball with us. It's so nice. And so I realized this. I learned that also that he had gone to Wayne State University, got his bachelor's degree some years before I was born, I guess. But in any case, and I went to this meeting, went to the registration desk, and they gave me a little card to wear on my shirt, and there was a man sitting next to this who didn't look like the ladies who were taking care of these things, and he said, do do you know Barney Axelrod? And I said, I've only heard about him, but everything I've heard is good. And he took the card and he stamped on it and it said, friend of Barney Axelrod. It turned out that in an earlier meeting, Barney had gone and opened a little party for his friends.
Who was the one you spoke with at the registration desk?
No.
Oh, somebody.
But the one I spoke with was one of his proteges. And he, at that meeting, told everybody in the meeting, here's the address. Go there. Knock on the door. Say, I'm a friend of Barney Axelrod's, and they'll let you in. So the party was overwhelmed with people. So here I was, and I had this badge that said, friend of Barney Axelrod.
Your entrance.
I went out talked to some people, and there was a group of people there, and I realized that one of them was Barney Axelrod. And so when the group broke up, he came over and said, can I buy you a cup of coffee? And I thought, this is wonderful. So I got to know him slightly then. But I run into him in other circumstances later. At the end of graduate school, I thought, now I've got to get a regular paying job and have a wife, and that would be reasonable. But there are things called postdoctoral fellowships. So we went to Chicago for a couple of years, and that was a grand experience.
We're at the university or
the University of Chicago, yeah. Then I got a job at Wayne State University as an assistant professor. I was there for 6 years, and then I was asked to come to Washington to serve as a rotating program director at the National Science Foundation of the Molecular Biology Program. Molecular biology was very new.
That's what I've
heard. Very. So I was like, I'll be back in my hometown. That'd be swell. So we did. We went there.
And did I you have any children by that time? Or?
Yes. By that time I had two. And we had a very nice year there, and that job was nice.
Did you know it was only going to be a 1 year? Because sometimes those program directors, maybe I've heard others, maybe they've changed it. So.
Well, I realized that there were program directors who had been there for long time, and numbers stayed for 2 years or 3 years, that sort of thing.
Mm-hmm.
But Barney Axelrod appeared. I was back in Detroit checking with my students, and he came into the lab, and I was now on speaking terms with him, and I was delighted to see him, and he said, would you consider coming to Purdue? And it didn't take a minute to say yes, because of him, from what I knew about him, I said, certainly I would do that. So it was that he recruited me. I came and they heard my speech, and then I had the job.
What year was this now?
1967.
Okay. What was the what was housing like? And when you, did you come take an interview, have an interview beforehand, or if you just come straight on?
After
you got the offer.
Yeah, I had come for the interview and looked around a little bit. We came again. My wife came with me, and we looked for a house. We got people to buy one, and there were a few houses that were available and waiting. So we got one that was very nice. It was easily done, and of course it seemed like pretty expensive, $35,000, but now it's worth about $200,000.
Is it the same house you have now?
Yes.
Oh, nice.
It's just appreciated. It's clearly the best investment that we'd ever made or would make.
Now you can fill out that application to Harvard, right?
Well, yeah. But it happened in that way that we found this. And it struck me when I came here that this was like Deanna Durbin movie. There were houses with picket fences and beautiful gardens, and it was quiet and nice and all these things. And it was just charming. as it could be. I've been living in all these big cities all that time. And so this was a nice change. Right.
Well, then, now that you're, tell us when you first came, what your appointment was, and what sort of things you did, and then go on to your research and photosynthesis.
Well, I came, I suppose.
Was it in this building, Biochem was in this building at
yeah,
that time?
The building was here, and I think I was hired in as an associate professor, and the promise was in a year I would be promoted to be a professor, which was.
Did you get tenure then with the associate?
Yeah. And so that was a great gift that fell upon me. I'm trying to think. This Barney Axelrod was, of course, the chairman. And there were some of the biochemistry faculty over in the animal science building was next to us, but that was all. And Barney had come and sort of renewed the faculty. He hired a number of people who came before me and after me. We were pretty well stocked. Got only one or two more beyond that. I had a strange attitude, and then I thought teaching was quite an important thing to do. And many of the young Turks who loved me had been drilled into the notion that it's a waste of time and you have to do science every minute. But in any case, I soon got a chance to teach a large course. It was introductory biochemistry for non-majors, and usually about 100 students were involved. It was 3 lectures a week. They were all took a laboratory session every week, and about this time, the Vietnam War turned sour, and things were getting, you know, there were some riots and things like that in the air. It struck me that I had a teacher in college who had caused the students to sit in numbered chairs, and she told them, you know, the chairs in there are numbered from 1 to 100, and there's a list there of students, you'll find the number and say there. And a week later, she knew all our names. I thought that was really neat. If you want people to be interested in what you're saying, you're going to at least find out what their name was. So I did that. I got to know a lot of students that way. Eventually, my memory dissolved, but for many years I taught that course. These were students who were largely from the School of Agriculture, who were taking plant and animal management and these kinds of things. And there were females who were in home economics, which became family science later on. There was a striking difference at that time that females generally were well-dressed and well-mannered, and they got A's and B's. After 5 or 6 years, it changed, and they weren't well-dressed, and they used bad language, and they got C's and D's. It was such nice things at that time. So that changed. I did this for a very long period of time. In between, of course, doing science and getting graduate students, the regular kinds of things in a research career. And I was always able to get some grants, which I saw the value of was providing salary for students. That was the great thing. We would have these folks there. They could do this, learn, and at the same time subsist. So that worked very nicely. I had, on several occasions, because I had worked at the National Science Foundation, became a candidate for a management kind of job at the Department of Agriculture. Department of Agriculture had...
That's the all, U.S. Department of Agriculture.
Yeah, the USDA had always applied for, or at least for many years since the Civil War, I suspect, when these colleges became... There was special money that they sent to the... there's a name for it. It was the date, like 1860s, the College of...
The Land Grant?
Land Grant Colleges, that's right. And the Land Grant, of course, provided money for the buildings and all that sort of thing. But the Department of Agriculture had special funds for Land Grant Colleges to support agriculture. And so they made grants to people who were doing really agricultural technology. It would be too kind to say that it was science, but they were doing important things.
I know what you're talking about. I've heard of people when they used to have that.
But it happened, and I have to try and get the time straight. I'm not quite sure on it, but I think it was when Jimmy Carter came to be the president, there had been a decline in the grain production in the world, and there was a sort of concern that there might be mass famines, and so the government should do something about this. And it was decided then to make a special program in agriculture to help boost production, apply modern techniques to the understanding of production. So that meant doing science. So because I'd worked at NSF, someone must have told them that I had done that and I was in the College of Agriculture and that I should be contacted. So it happened that when this thing got going, there was another fellow ahead of me who became the head of this effort to build a grants program for doing science. And the program was not limited to colleges of agriculture or any kind of place, but its ultimate purpose was to assist agriculture through
right.
understanding it. So I took a year off to do that, had another nice year in Washington, D.C. And my children were growing up then. That was pleasant experience, but after the year was up, I said, I've got to go back to my regular life now, but a year or two later, they said, the fellow we had lined up for this year couldn't come, could you please come? You can have any kind of appointment you want, so I got one where I could go for 3 days a week there, 3 days a week here, in fact. So I did that for some time, but I ran into a really strange experience. It happened that a new president had gone to the White House, and there was a new Secretary of Agriculture, and new people below the Secretary that had pretty sort of jobs. And I had been preparing the office to run 8 evaluation panels in a period of about 3 weeks, and each one of them involved bringing in a dozen people from outside, and then they would read the proposals and select the best ones and so forth. So that was all set to go, and the phone came to the office and said, here to delay the meetings because the evaluators will have to be evaluated themselves for their competence in this job. And I had understood that it had been my job to do. And I was stunned. I thought, what are we going to do? Tell all those people not to come? And I called up a very famous brilliant scientist at Harvard who was on the advisory board, and he said, I know just what to do. And wait a few days, things will get better. So he called up the newspapers, the New York Times, and also Time Magazine, and all these people who knew he was a big guy in science. And he first called up the man who made this ruling that we had to postpone the meetings, and the man said, yes, we're going to have members of our party go and interview these people and their superiors, and the FBI will do a special check then on the records and see it. And so my friend at Harvard explained this to the press broadly, and suddenly I came to Washington and grabbed the New York Times coming in, and on the front page it said, Lysenko is in the Department of Agriculture. The government is now interfering with the distribution and judging of grants, and it's a political move. So there was a big fuss, and then a couple of days later, I got a call from the man above me, and he said, you can have your meeting on schedule. He was mad at me because he knew I had told the world, so that ended my career at the Department of Agriculture, but I didn't mind a bit. So
well, it made you look, because you'd already got these people all lined up, and then at the last minute, and they were competent. You knew the people. You
yes,
wouldn't have asked them.
That had been my job.
Sure, to screen, to search and screen.
Beyond that, you know, there was this aroma of politics that, now that we've captured the White House, we've kind of cracked down on these people and that sort of thing, which comes and goes. So anyhow, that was a nice instruction in life.
That's right, yeah.
But they never asked me to come back. I was glad of it.
Got away pretty soon. Tell us a little bit about your research, the photosynthesis, and that you've been spending comments for the researchers on that.
At the very beginning of my career, I was at a course in college where the professor was a botanist, but he had great reverence for one of the pages in the text that was the structure of chlorophyll, and he conveyed the notion that if we could really understand how that works, it would be a great step forward in photosynthesis. And somehow, when I got to Johns Hopkins, there was a newly hired professor there who studied photosynthesis, and I chose to work with him. Hence, even in the very first year I was there, there were experiments being talked about that turned out to be very, very important in understanding sunlight can be turned into new plants, and so the scientific business was always very interesting because of this flow of new ideas, new information, and things like that. Now it seems that a lot of people say photosynthesis is completely solved, and then there are others who are saying, no, there's still some very things that we have to work our way through and see exactly how it works. In a contemporary sense, we now have this big problem with the high carbon dioxide output, and the global warming, and the need for fuel, and need for fuel, especially to replace the oil. We don't have quite as much as we should, but in any case, I have been studying not all plants, but algae, the ones that grow in water, and it's their capacity is to produce more material through photosynthesis per acre of land than any crop, even if you have ponds where everything is at nice warm temperature and they have the right nutrients and so forth, you can get a lot of plants out of it. And this has led to a funny name called biodiesel. And there are lots of engineers and operators roaming around saying we're going to grow this stuff and we'll put it in engines for an airplane and fly it away. But it's not going to be that easy. It's got a lot of fantasy in that. But one of my students became the curator of the collection of algae, the largest one in the United States. It's the largest one in the world. And it's located at the University of Texas. And now when I talk to him, he tells me about all these people who are coming to him, and they want the magic word so they can let biodiesel and do all these wonderful things. And he's quite skeptical about the whole thing.
Interesting.
But
how the face changes.
Yes, I think if we truly understood how the conversion of energy and light is translated into chemical work, we might be able to do something very important. But we don't really know what's doing there yet, so that's a challenge left for us.
Let's talk a little about the department and how it's changed over time. You had some department. Oxford was here for a pretty long time, wasn't he?
Yes.
And has the department also grown as well as over time?
It's not grown a whole lot. I think it was probably around 15 people when I came in it. Now it's a little over 20.
So it's stayed within that?
Yeah, it's fairly stable. There have been expansions in space to do science so that we have some rooms in the building next door and some on the other side of the street.
Oh, and the Hanson?
Yeah, the Hanson building, and over here this one, where there are a couple of labs that are assigned to us. There was some talk when President Jishke arrived that this might lead to a big expansion in biochemistry, but Jishke was an engineer, and he expanded engineering, and some of those guys over there are doing things that are related to biological processes now, but it just was a great deal.
Sure, yeah.
Stir for
when,
us.
When you came, Hubdy was the president.
Correct.
So, and then Hanson, Hicks, Dr. Baring, Jeske, and President Porter. Mm-hmm. So I've seen, how many department heads have there been after Oxirod, or is there a couple after that?
Departments, I think Axelrod, and then the next one was a man named Don Carlson, and then he was followed by Mark Henderson, and now we have Clint Chappell.
Wasn't there Forney?
That's right, Jim Forney did it. That was an interesting thing. Hermanson did it for quite a while, and he's gotten tired of it, and they tried to hire him. And it seems that we have had a chronic problem in hiring, because in the world of biochemistry, the largest number of those people exist in the medical side. There are wonderful biochemistry departments in the big medical schools and so forth.
I see.
So when they hire a new chairman, they promise him $1 million in equipment and $1 million in salaries for everybody and all that sort of thing. And we can't do that. So generally the fact they wanted to hire a big star but could never afford it. And so Jim Forney volunteered to take a short term at it. He wanted to be a scientist. And so he served a few years there. Now Glenn Chappell has made the same arrangement. He's promised him he's not going to stay for life. They're going to get busy and try to get somebody.
Do some of the biochem graduates, do they go into medical facilities then?
Yes.
Do they, so they're affiliated mainly with the schools?
Yes.
All right. Okay.
There's been one graduate that I've heard of, I don't know personally, but he turned out to be a brilliant guy. He got a Nobel Prize. He was, for a time, at University in St. Louis, and he was Washington University in St. Louis. He was climbed up in the hierarchy there. And he's at the very forefront. He's always been in the medical departments since he went here. So he was in that category. We've had another brilliant man, I wish I could think of his name. Learned too many names. There was a black student who came in the time of Carl Siemens' time, and he was very gifted. And he's now a vice president of Merck, a huge drug company out of New York, New Jersey, area. He's way up there in the world.
What business. Do the career goals for some of the other students do? Some of them go into teaching or where?
Yeah.
Say at the undergraduate.
There's an interesting thing about that that Clint brought up and is being discussed. That is that our students who got a PhD here are less likely to be hired in a teaching institution because of our reputation in doing research, and that we should do something about that. I say that it was substantially true in the case of several of the students that graduated from my lab, that they spent a very long time trying to get a job as a teacher, not as a researcher, but they would do research then.
Sure, but they primarily were just
teaching.
They wanted
to be teaching. And
right.
Evidently, small schools look at them and say, that guy's not going to be like us. We're not going to take him.
Right.
So that's been somewhat of an hindrance, I think.
Okay. Let's talk a little bit about how about fundraising, how that's changed over time.
It's been marvelous to look at. When I came, it was why we said that President Humvee was concerned about the faculty getting too many grants because he thought the state should be the principal provider of funds for the state university.
Being the land grant.
Yeah, and being
in
a very general sort of way, I think.
Mm-hmm.
And I did see him once in a situation that warmed my heart. That was at a time of protests, and there was a great gathering in the auditorium of all the faculty. Often it happens that the president gives a public talk this. At this time there were all the unrest and the unpleasantness that went with it. And someone, I forget exactly what it was, but it, someone got up and asked the question, what do you think of the war in Vietnam? And he said, none of your business.
He answered the question.
That was a really good answer for me. But I, at that time, I would have imagined that most of the citizens who had received a degree here said that the school was supposed to educate us. We don't have to give them money. The state should be taken care of. But slowly, the trend changed. And now, and it's true in all the universities that the president is the biggest fundraiser that they can find. And there's talk about some of these places becoming private institutions. They're getting all their money from outside. The state isn't doing much.
It's hard.
Yeah.
Were you ever a faculty fellow while you've been here? Pupti started that faculty fellow program in the residence halls, and you get to interact with the students.
Yes.
And sort of you see the faculty outside the classroom. Like I've been a faculty fellow at Tarkington for a long period of time.
No, somehow.
I think it, and now that the, most of the eating facilities have been conglomerated into other facilities, because the idea was to go there once a week, which we used to do, and have dinner with the students, and then when they have events and things, you know. But I think it's making some changes because of that.
I have fallen into something quite accidentally, though, that sort of parallels this. I was studying the special kinds of algae, and I went to a meeting. And I had read that there was a place in Mexico where they grew these algae for health food. I went to a meeting and found a man who was from Mexico City there, and I said, "Could you tell me something about this?" And he had never heard of it. So a while later, he sent me a letter and said, "Would you please come down and visit our lab for a couple of weeks, because I found these things so interesting." I chatted and said, "Yeah, I'm trying to get help. That's a good project." So I made a friend there who's the treasurer. After some time, he realized that the Mexican government was going to change the standards of their research by requiring that it be published not in local Spanish journals, but in English. And over time, I noticed that the requirements for learning French and German to read science faded away. And finally, it was the German and French magazines, journals, had all English papers in them. And when you went to a meeting abroad, everybody spoke English. So my friend said, "Could you come down and help us? The faculty here is going to learn English that's good enough to get published." So I gave a little course there, and that's then been going on for about 20 years.
You're still doing it?
Yeah. And over time, I realized that the best thing I could do for them was to insist that they write a lot every day, and I would correct it and give it back to them the next day, and they had to learn to talk in English better. They had to have 2 years in high school of English, and they could stumble through, and if they had watched a lot of television, that improved their English speaking. So I go there, and I have the midday meal with the Air Force students every day, and we talk over lunch. When I first did this, and I said, "Now we're going to have a special day where you give an oral presentation in English," they're agreeing. But they did, and it worked out very well. And I told them, "You're going to go there, and people will speak with Chinese accents, and it's really hard. So you'll be among people who are having the same problems." And they realize that. So it's been a nice experience.
That's right. That's nice, because the proviso, the best writing is rewriting, holds true for that as well.
Yeah.
About any awards or honors that you'd like to share with, anything comes to mind?
Only award that is substance is the Mexican university where I go gave me a special, beautiful engraved metal plate thanking me for helping their students over the last 20 years and providing a new outlook on science in Mexico.
That's kind of special.
Yes.
All right. How about your post-Purdue years? What, do you continue with your research?
I continue doing research, and I continue teaching in Mexico.
What time of the year do you go?
I've been going in February.
As long as you have a choice.
Yes. That's about when their semester starts.
And approximately how long? Do you stay for the whole semester?
No, I really give them a 3-week course. And they have a couple of hours of lecture every other day. They have to turn in a paper every other day. I have to grade them. That's why there's it's every other day. If I could go twice as fast, I could do it daily, but that's the time I make that.
How about, got a favorite Purdue tradition? Outstanding event in your life. You can take either both.
I'd like to hear the song when it's played, full orchestra and things like that.
Right.
It's a very nice thing. And I think, what was the president who came from Indianapolis where he'd been in medical school?
Oh, Dr. Barron. Steve Barron.
He was very interested in improving the graduation ceremonies, and I had to go to those every few years, and I thought he did a very good job of that. I appreciate now the dignity of the ceremonies. Yes.
He got the banners, you yes. know, out of that, and yes. now they have the mace, and it really is nice. They're one of the few schools I tell students, oh, I want to go. I said, you should. It's one of the few schools that you still get your diploma handed to you,
yeah.
you know?
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, and the parents like it, so it yes. works out. I love graduation. Any closing comments that you'd like to share in retrospect? I'd like to share with your researchers.
It's happened in my years of retirement that something else has come up in
good.
My life that it doesn't relate necessarily to Purdue, but I was asked by my parish to take communion to the Catholics in assisted living place, which is called Heritage Healthcare, which is only a mile or so from my house. And I have come to find that all